Christian Audio presents I Call You Mine, Embracing God's Gift of Adoption by Kim de Blecourt, narrated by Anne Richardson. To my brothers and sisters around the world caring for the orphaned and vulnerable, I see Christ in your efforts to fulfill our Father's mandate to care for the fatherless. I am humbled to walk beside you. Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. Isaiah chapter 43, verse 1. Week 1. Adoption's Foundation. Day 1. It all begins with love. God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Romans chapter 5, verse 8. Adoption is wonderful and beautiful and the greatest blessing I have ever experienced. Adoption is also difficult and painful. Adoption is a beautiful picture of redemption. Katie J. Davis. Kisses from Katie. A story of relentless love and redemption. The Search for Love. His name was Sasha, and he was 3 years old. He clung to the fingers of the middle-aged woman who walked him into the doctor's office that summer afternoon in Ismail, Ukraine. Our son's orphaned status was obvious. His shaved head, mismatched clothing, and downturned eyes pricked my heart. My first eye contact with him seemed to seal his fate to mine. He was ours, and I knew at that moment that my love for him was unconditional. It was during the adoption of our son that God led me to understand my own adoption. I was not an orphaned little one in need of earthly parents, as Sasha was. I had parents, but I lacked embracing and feeling the loving arms of my heavenly parent. For most of my life, I had been rebellious. I served no one but myself. Although I had been raised in a Christian household, I was not Christian. I felt ugly inside. I didn't love myself, let alone others. I needed a parent to rescue me, to save me, to adopt me, unconditionally, forever. I'm overwhelmed when I stop to really consider the mess I was before God adopted me. It wasn't just that I was headed toward an eternity without him. I needed his loving care, guidance, and discipline in this life, right here and right now. I needed to understand the goodness of healthy boundaries, the depth of unconditional love, and the safe feeling of completely belonging to a family who would never abandon me. I needed to grow up under the watchful eye of a father who would teach me and keep me safe, who would continue to love me even when I made mistakes. When God adopted me, when he made me his and took me in as a full and privileged member of his forever family, it changed my life, my perspective, and my potential in a way I could never have experienced apart from him. And it was all because of his unquenchable and overpowering love for me. Having experienced that kind of love from God, I was able to reach out and adopt and love a child who also needed to experience that kind of love. I wanted to give our child in an earthly way what God had given me, healthy boundaries, the depth of unconditional love, and the safe feeling of completely belonging to a family who would never abandon him. And most of all, I wanted to introduce our child to the God who loves unconditionally and who loves far better and greater than I, as a parent, ever could. I chose my son just as God chose me and just as he chose you. God finds us first before we even realize our need for a parent and for a family. The orphan doesn't select the parent. The parent chooses the orphan. That is how the family begins. It's the same with us. We don't reach out in love for God first. He chose us. He loved us first. That is how we joined His family. And it all began with love. 1. Before God adopted us, we were far from Him. Read the following passages and list what condition God found us in. Romans chapter 5, verses 6 through 8. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. 2. In what ways do you think adoption reflects the concept of redemptive love? What love does for us. Think of someone you love. Someone you love so much you would die for him or her. Now think of the opposite. Someone you do not care for. Someone you cannot stand even to be in the same room with. Would you be as willing to die for this person? Would you be willing to sacrifice the life of your child for them? Probably not. And yet God loved us when we were far from Him, when we hated Him, rebelled against Him, ignored Him, and jeered at Him. As sinners, that is who we are. Before our redemption and adoption, we were His enemies. We were filthy with our sin. Yet He loved us. God loved us so much that He sacrificed His one and only Son so we might live as adopted children belonging to Him. Think about that for a moment. What if you were willing to sacrifice for your enemy? Would you also be able to then take in that enemy and make him or her a legal, rightful heir to everything you own? Would you be willing to love with abandon that person and make them part of your family, with all its rights and privileges? And yet God did that for you and for me. It is purely in His love for us that we are saved and given a fresh start in a safe and loving family. Our love is merely a reflection of His love. Our love is not the origin of our salvation. Our redemption, our adoption, is made possible only through His love for us. His Spirit fills our hearts with love in response to what He did for us while we were far from Him. What does that love do for us? The Apostle John tells us, "This is how God showed His love among us. He sent His one and only Son into the world that we might live through Him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another." 1 John chapter 4, verses 9 through 11. John reasons with us to display this love. We are to show the love we have so undeservingly received, perhaps especially to those who have done nothing to deserve it. No wonder loving, caring for, and adopting the orphan is so close to God's heart for His followers. God adopted us, so therefore we adopt others. Often, like those we adopt, the situations God found us in were anything but beautiful or safe or healthy. What a wonderful reminder of how far God has brought us. 3. In Romans chapter 8, verses 38 through 39, Paul described God's love for us. Read the passage, then using your own words, describe God's love for you. 4. How is God's love for you described in each of the following verses? Psalm 100, verse 5. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 5. 1 John chapter 4, verses 8 through 9. How adoption reflects God's love. People from all walks of life adopt. Adoption is not limited to Christians. However, adoption often means something different to those who follow God. My husband and I felt strongly led to adopt. We had discussed that option even before we discussed marriage. It was part of who we were as a couple. As we studied Scripture and sought to apply it, we knew adoption was part of God's calling on our lives, a reflection to that child and to the world of what God's saving work does. We have shared our story with other adoptive families, and they with us. Others have experienced this same beautiful awakening to the similarities between redemption and adoption. It isn't new or unique, yet often the idea of human adoption reflecting our own spiritual redemption occurs to everyone as a sudden and beautiful revelation, a revelation all made possible by God's overwhelming love. The deepest and strongest foundation of adoption is located not in the act of humans adopting humans, but in God adopting humans. John Piper, Reclaiming Adoption, Missional Living Through the Rediscovery of Abba Father. 5. Write out what spiritual adoption means to you as you consider God seeking, loving, and embracing you. 6. In what ways does understanding spiritual adoption change your perspective on adopting a child into your family? Scripture Memorization for Week 1. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Romans chapter 8, verses 38 through 39. Prayer. Dear Father, you alone could save me from the condition you found me in. Thank you for your great love, from which I can never be separated. Thank you for adopting me into your family. Thank you for choosing me and continuing to love and choose me. Thank you that I can respond to your love by choosing and adopting others who are near and dear to your heart. In Jesus' name, amen. Day 2. Love Throughout Adoption. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. 1 John chapter 3, verse 1. Caring for orphans means, in a very real sense, joining them in their distress. Russell D. Moore, Adopted for Life, The Priority of Adoption for Christian Families and Churches. Love's Commitment. When Laura Lee and her husband Doyle adopted their daughter, they flew to South Korea, met their daughter's foster parents, and learned about Korean culture. When they met her, their 6.5-month-old girl had already formed a bond with her foster parents. Laura Lee was grateful they had invested so much love in her daughter's early life because she understood her daughter had healthy attachment development. However, they realized it might be difficult for their daughter when they took her home as their adopted child. "We looked different, we spoke different, and we smelled different," Laura Lee explained. "Add to that, we were taking her from the only parents she had ever known. We braced ourselves for her reaction, but they couldn't have imagined the intensity of their baby's response. She cried and screamed nonstop. She cried herself to sleep for a short while, but then awoke, took one look at Laura Lee, and began to scream again. My heart broke for her," Laura Lee said. Laura Lee did her best to soothe and comfort the new addition to their family. After an extremely long and sleepless night, Laura Lee sat her baby on the tiny bathroom sink's edge, placed her child's tiny feet in warm water, and stood behind her. "We gazed at each other through the sink's mirror. It would be easy after that night to wonder what they had gotten themselves into, but as her baby looked intensely at her reflection, Laura Lee realized they would make it. It would be a long haul, but Laura Lee wasn't going to give up. She had me, and I told her, 'It's you and me, girl.'" The crying continued all the way home. At 30,000 feet in the air, Laura Lee thought about what being an adoptive parent meant. "I didn't adopt my daughter only through the good and easy times. That's when it struck me. This is just like God's rock-solid commitment to us." God's love for us never fades. It doesn't go away when we fight and scream and wail against Him. He remains true to us. 1. Listen again to 1 John chapter 3, verse 1, or read it from another translation. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. 1 John chapter 3, verse 1. As you contemplate the Apostle Paul's words, what thought immediately comes to your mind? 2. Was there ever a time when you wondered how God could remain faithful to you? What helped you remember God's character traits and commitment to you? 3. In what ways have you considered your commitment level to your adopted child in light of God's commitment to you? 4. Read the following passages and list how God's love for you is described in each verse. Psalm 86, verse 15. Zephaniah, chapter 3, verse 17. 1 John, chapter 4, verses 7 through 8. Love's faithfulness, calm counsel, and patience. God is the perfect model of faithfulness for us. The Bible is filled with His qualities of love and commitment. They are also evident in our own lives. It can be difficult to hold ourselves to such holy standards, and we may wonder how in the world we can possibly show that kind of love and commitment to our children. But the Bible offers us a beautiful picture of one person who acted with that kind of strength, a person who can be our model. We often think of the book of Esther as strictly about the importance of fasting and trusting God in our acts of boldness. But it also shows adoptive parents a powerful role model for how to love and stay true to our children. Esther's cousin, Mordecai, is a great example of respecting the adopted child and guiding them through difficult times. We meet Mordecai in chapter 2 and learn of his adoptive role in Esther's life. Though the details are scarce, we learn that Hadassah, also known as Esther, had neither mother nor father, and that Mordecai had taken her in as his own daughter. Esther chapter 2, verses 5 through 7. It's interesting that since there's no mention of Mordecai being married, he may have been a single adoptive father. Through Mordecai's role as adoptive father, we observe three ways he showed his love for Esther and for God. First, Mordecai showed his love through his faithfulness to Esther. In chapter 2, we learn that Esther was taken to the king's eunuch, where she soon found favor. While Mordecai didn't prevent her from going to the palace, we learn in verse 11, every day he walked back and forth near the courtyard of the harem to find out how Esther was and what was happening to her. Esther was moved to the grandest place in town, and yet Mordecai loved and thought enough of Esther to walk to where she was staying, hoping to learn how she was. Mordecai surely had other things to do, yet the adoptive father in him had to check and make sure his girl was okay. The second way Mordecai showed his love for Esther was in his calm counsel to her. When Mordecai learned of Haman's, the king's, second-in-command, order to exterminate the Jewish people throughout the kingdom, he calmly counseled Esther. First, he explained the order to kill all Jews. Then he asked her to go before the king and beg for mercy on behalf of all Jews. When Esther reminded him that anyone who went before the king without being summoned could be killed, rather than getting upset with her, Mordecai once again calmly counseled. He reminded Esther that God would find a way to save his people, with or without Esther. Then he encouraged her with his now famous advice, "Who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this?" Esther chapter 4, verse 14. Removing emotion while giving counsel, especially while parenting, is important to remember. The third way Mordecai showed his love for Esther is through his patience. Mordecai waited for everything. Daily he waited to hear how Esther was. He waited for Esther's responses. He waited to see how God would answer their prayers. How often must we rely on patience only God can supply? From the moment we begin to think of adopting, our arms become strangely empty, and it is only through God's love that we find His inspired patience to endure. As we bring our children home, we must have patience in the adjustment period and through each new challenge. Patience provides time to remember our commitment and depth of love. It gives us the power to think and respond clearly and respectfully. 5. Read Esther chapter 2, verse 5 through chapter 4, verse 17. What strikes you about the adoptive relationship between Mordecai and Esther? 6. How else did Mordecai exemplify love to Esther? 7. Of the three traits we looked at with Mordecai, faithfulness, calm counsel, and patience, which do you struggle with the most? Why? 8. In what ways could you rely on God's help and strength to pursue that trait for your child's sake? 9. Read the following passage and describe the theme of each verse. Esther chapter 4, verse 16. Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. Joshua chapter 1, verse 9. 10. Why are these themes important for us to remember and embrace in our own parenting? Our power source. As parents, we have the incredible opportunity to show the love God has showed us and to influence those He has entrusted to us. Throughout the many phases of parenthood, maintaining a consistent front, regardless of the tremendous love we feel, is challenging. This is especially true during times of adolescent stress or when your beautiful child is screaming anything but loving words your way. Adoptive parenting often requires amplified parenting skills. Mordecai modeled wonderful attributes directly relatable to adoptive parents today. By remaining committed to Esther's well-being, providing her calm counsel, and remaining exceedingly patient, together, God was able to use them both in a powerful way. That's the gift of love in adoption. Adoption is a family idea, conceived in terms of love and viewing God as Father. In adoption, God takes us into His family and fellowship. He establishes us as His children and heirs. Closeness, affection, and generosity are at the heart of the relationship. J.I. Packer, Knowing God. Scripture Memorization for Week 1. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Romans chapter 8, verses 38 through 39. Prayer. Dear Father, thank you for your loving faithfulness to me. Thank you for your calm counsel through your Holy Spirit and your Word. Thank you for your infinite patience. You are such a personal, loving Father. Help me remember Mordecai's example while I pursue loving and committed parenting. In Jesus' name, Amen. Day 3. A Heart Like His. You were taught to be made new in your hearts, to become a new person. That new person is made to be like God, made to be truly good and holy. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 23 through 24. God wants you to be just like Jesus. He wants you to have a heart like His. Max Lucado, A Heart Like Jesus. I see you, Father. I was turning in a permission slip at the school office when our son's teacher asked, "Can I talk to you for a minute?" Simply hearing those words stirred up curiosity and anxiety. "Your son made me cry today," she stated. Uh-oh, I thought. He must have been pretty bad to make his teacher cry. One of the boys was sitting alone on the bench during recess. I watched your son stop what he was doing and go to him. Soon, he had his arm around his classmate's shoulders, and the boy joined your son and his friends, and they all played together. His teacher was obviously touched by what she had witnessed, and her eyes welled with tears again. I was so proud of him. I thought you might be too, she continued. I just had to share that with you. And that's how it happens. Unexpectedly, surprisingly, joyously, all the love you pour into your children comes back to you in a short conversation, a note, or a shared photo. I recognized my Heavenly Father's fingerprints all over that moment. My small boy from another land and language had never known family. He had adjusted poorly to orphanage life, even though he had been there since he was only 1 month old. His rough attitude at 3 had landed him in the 5-year-old group at the home. At his tender age, he scuffled often with the other boys and knew how to throw a punch. Yet, through the prompting only God can give, our family from the other side of the world stumbled wide-eyed through paperwork, fingerprinting, and repeated processing. And through our naive family, God poured into our little boy's heart, loved him, and changed his life forever. And when that teacher told me my son had turned and shared love with another lonely little boy, I whispered to God, "I see you in that child we traveled around the world for. I see you, Father." And that's when the love of God took on a deeper, personal meaning. And all I could do was pray, "Thank you for this child. Thank you for his tender heart and love for you. Give me, too, a heart just like yours. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh." Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26. 1. What does it mean to have a new heart? 2. When was a time you witnessed or learned about a compassionate, out-of-character deed your child performed? 3. How did it feel to recognize God's fingerprints on your child at that moment? 4. Read the following passages. For each verse, describe how God's love impacts us. John chapter 13, verses 34 through 35. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 6 through 7. Becoming a child after God's own heart. When I think of having a heart like God's, I can't help but think of King David. David repeatedly directed his heart toward God throughout his life. It seemed to be what got him through so many of life's difficulties. Whenever something challenging would happen, David would admit it to God. For example, in Psalm 31, he said, "For I hear many whispering, terror on every side. They conspire against me and plot to take my life." Verse 13. But then he would restate his confidence in God. "But I trust in you, Lord. I say, you are my God." Verse 14. David would then continue his request and or praise of God. Verses 15 through 16. While turning to God when in distress is a simple truth many of us learned in Sunday school, I've witnessed many adoptive parents, and all Christians, rather than crying out to God, turn elsewhere for help. And I notice only because I've found it true too often in my own life. There are so many resources available for adoptive families now that weren't available even a decade ago. Books, blogs, and therapeutic help in person or online. Regardless of what I was dealing with, I found I started to reach for our therapist's phone number first, only later to ask God for his help with the latest family need or development. Can you relate? When I read David's Psalms, though, I realized one day that I hadn't been seeking a heart like God's. I humbly asked the Spirit to prompt me to take everything to God first, concerning our adoptive family's needs. God answered that prayer and gave me the yearning to be a child after His heart, to seek His thoughts and counsel and ways first. It has saved me and our family from much heartache and many mistakes. 5. How can we pursue a heart like His? 6. In what ways can you teach your adopted child to love with a heart like His? 7. Read the following passages. How does each encourage your new heart? Psalm 28, verse 7. Jeremiah chapter 24, verse 7. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22. Family resemblance. "My goodness, you look just like your father," the woman said to my daughter. "Yes, I know," my daughter replied, having heard that same pronouncement multiple times from multiple people. "I'm sure you've heard it before. A friend of mine even jokes that dogs tend to resemble their owners. But it's hard to deny that there is a resemblance that comes with being related to one another in a family. It even happens to adoptive families. One of the things my husband and I hear is, "Your son looks like his mother, and your daughter looks like her father." We don't feel the need to explain or say, "That's funny, one of them is adopted." We simply say, "Thank you, we are a family." We acknowledge the resemblance, graciously accept it, and revel in the mystery of it. That's what having a heart like His is about. When we become children of God, two changes happen. First, we go from being dead in our sin to being alive in Him. See Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 5. Second, our hearts start to be transformed. Little by little, the Holy Spirit sculpts our hearts. No longer having a heart of stone, but given a heart of flesh, our hearts respond to the Spirit's leading and to be obedient to God. Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26. The heart change continues through our walk in the Spirit, only to be perfected when we see Jesus face to face. 1 John chapter 3, verses 2 through 3. More and more we resemble our brother, Jesus, and our Father, God. We are family. This is what our redemption, our adoption into God's family, is about. Family resemblance. Because it is through that family resemblance that others will see God through us. Our human adoption gives us the incredible chance to see God's love for us through His eyes as the adopter. That is what so many adoptive families have discovered, the marvelous God perspective, all because of His great love. Ultimately, God calls us to adopt for Him. It's His heart that beats and breaks for the orphan, the lost, and the lonely. And it is only because He calls us, equips us, and sustains us that we are able to fulfill His purposes. And I believe He delights in transforming His children into the likeness of His Son along the way. Stephanie Hannan, Why Does God Call People to Adopt? Show Hope Blog. 8. Write out how having a new heart has changed your life. Scripture memorization for week 1. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Romans chapter 8, verses 38 through 39. Prayer. Dear Father, You alone are righteous and holy. You have modeled perfect love for me. You have changed my stone heart to a responsive heart. Continue to lead me to love as You do. Help me to resemble You as the perfect parent as I strive to love my children. In Jesus' name, amen. Day 4. Fierce Love. set me as a seal upon your heart, as a seal upon your arm, for love is strong as death, jealousy is fierce as the grave. Song of Solomon, chapter 8, verse 6. I'm not sure when I first realized that my love for my children was a fierce love, whatever event or time it came over me, that this was not a quiet, comfortable, sit-down-by-the-fire love. Rather, it was a fierce love characterized by strong emotion and equally strong action. Marilyn Gardner, Fierce Love, Communicating Across Boundaries blog. Love can be fierce. Love can be described in many ways: romantic, sacrificial, patient, kind, giving. At one time or another, I have experienced each of those types. One type of love I never experienced, however, until I became an adoptive parent, was fierce love. As I've spoken with other adoptive parents, they've said the same. Allison understands this kind of fierce love that swept over her and surprised her with its intensity. She and her husband Brian knew their second adopted son had heart issues, similar to their first adopted son. However, this little boy had significant heart and lung issues far beyond their first son's complications. They knew going into the adoption that they didn't know how his health would progress. I began questioning if I could physically handle it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.